What's going on? This is Don, and welcome to another Cinema 4D tutorial. Although really it's more of a breakdown and also just a showcase of my new concrete texture pack for Octane. I'm going to show you how to do this time-lapse effect in Octane, and going over how to do that, I am talking about Octane and some of the things in Octane, so that's the tutorial aspect of it, because we're using it to do this effect right here. But like I said, this is a showcase of my new concrete texture packs for Octane, so this is it right here. I will link this below the video if you want to go and check that out. There's a page with more information, a preview gallery, and so on. And this is actually one of three new Octane texture packs that I have released recently. So you've got metal, wood, and concrete. And again, there'll be more information about each of these on their respective pages. But anyway, I don't even have Cinema open right now, so let's do that. And I'm gonna load up an earlier version of the scene you just saw in After Effects, and then I'm gonna show you how to build it back up to this with the lighting and the time-lapse animation effect. And this is it right here. The animation is very basic. That we have at the beginning here, it's a camera morph setup, just going from the camera at the front near the entrance of this building and then going backwards to the second position here. So it's based on these two camera positions and then an animation in between. And I guess before I do some lighting, just a quick breakdown of the main materials we'll be looking at. It's the concrete material on the outside, the wood flooring on the inside, and the marble flooring here. Those are really the three main presets that I will quickly just break down for you. But before I do that, maybe let's I'm gonna load up my Octane layout, which is this kind of thing where I have the live viewer across from the main viewport, so I can always expand this area if I need more space. And my kernel settings, which is the Octane settings, these are docked in a tab next to the material section, because I figured I am never going to be looking at the materials and Octane settings at the same time, so it made sense to put them into this tabbed layout. And the other thing is the objects menu, which I undocked. I changed this to be icons only, so showing no text, changed the orientation, and then I docked it into the area above my live viewer, so it's easier access to grab things like lights and cameras and so on. So anyway, that's my layout for Octane. It works well for me, and maybe if you want to mimic this layout, that's how I did that. Okay, I'm gonna send the scene to the live viewer here, so we can start to see how it looks by default. It's gonna take a while to send everything through. There's a lot of materials in the scene which are not applied, but Octane still has to export all of them. But here we are. And actually, I guess before I do any breakdown of the materials, I should do the lighting, or some kind of lighting. So in that example you saw, I was using a daytime system or daylight system. So get this little sun icon, and here we go. By default, you would get this evening sunset lighting style. I want to start sometime during the day when it's harsher sunlight, and then transition into a nighttime scene. So the way to do this is, if I go to frame zero, let's go to the sun expression tag, which by the way, there are two tags on this. You've got the daylight tag where you control the power, that's just the overall brightness of the scene. I'm gonna leave this at one, which is the default. And actually everything here, I'm just going to leave at default because these settings look quite good straight away without really having to change them. So moving on, the sun expression, this is what's more important here to create that animation. I want to go to the basic tab and enable this so that it drives the lighting in the daylight tag. It's set to 1600 hours, which is 4 p.m. I want to start earlier than that at 2 p.m. This is going to be at frame zero. And for some reason, I cannot keyframe at frame 000. I don't know why. Maybe it's just an octane glitch or my system. But I have to go to frame one and then set a keyframe, and now it lets me do that. And if I go to 240, which is the end, I can set the time to say 2000 hours, which is 8 p.m. at night. And now I can set a keyframe for that. So if I scrub through, you see the time-lapse animation effect. I also want to change the latitude and longitude here. In the original example, I think I was working with something like 40 and 20 degrees for the longitude. So this is like changing the location of where you are on the planet. So maybe you want to simulate an actual real location. You would find out the coordinates for that and then use those values to drive your sun expression and the lighting in your scene. And already I would say this is looking quite good, but you can go to the Octane settings and in the kernel, the GI mode here. I'm currently working with the default GI ambient occlusion, which gives me this kind of look here. Now this might look fine, but this is actually not very realistic in the way that the light is bouncing around in the scene. So for example, there are no lights on the inside here, but you can see it's perfectly illuminated. For this to look more realistic, I have to change the GI mode. So let me first of all store the render buffer, which is going to save the current frame with the current settings. And I have this slider now, which if I change any of the settings over here, so let's change to GI diffuse. Now we're going to see the new settings on the left side, and I can compare the before and after. So if I was going for something that was more realistic, I would definitely be using this GI diffuse mode. And if I want to take that even further, so let's disable the buffer for a second and the comparison and store this again. And we can switch from direct lighting to path tracing. So a totally different menu for rendering. And this is what you would be using to get the most physically accurate kind of render. So if this was a real project and I wanted this to look as realistic as possible, I would be using this path tracing mode. Now, there's a whole lot of settings you can go over here. And there are a lot of terms and words that, you know, may not necessarily make a lot of sense. It's just a different language that Octane uses than, say, if you're used to the standard language in Cinema 4D. But I want to recommend some tutorials for you out there, which I found very useful as well. There is a website called InLife 3O Designs, and there are some really excellent Octane tutorials here, which I would really recommend if you're serious about learning Octane. There's a ton of free ones, which if you just go to the tutorial section and under Octane Render, you will find a ton of free lessons that you could go through. Some I would really recommend. I recommend all of them, but some really important ones, this one, for example, the kernel settings, where there are some image examples, you know, all nicely labeled with even some indicators for render time, you know, what doing, you know, or changing each setting will do to your render time, you know, as well as what it does to your image. So you can see all these examples. They're very well made and do a great job of explaining all the different settings in Octane. And another one I would really recommend is the render settings and optimization tutorial. This is another great lesson teaching you how to control Octane and how to get the best renders. And it even uses different types of scenes where you may have to account for different kinds of effects. So, you know, this scene, for example, deals with a lot of reflection and transparency, whereas lower down you're dealing with things like emission, you know, and surfaces which emit light and how to deal with those. So go and check that out, a really excellent resource for Octane. And I believe there is a full course you could buy as well if you want to really dive into Octane and see some real examples. And actually this even goes into things like texturing as well. Okay, let's go back to our scene in Octane, and you can see the path tracing is doing a much better job of producing a scene that looks better here. Of course that comes at the cost of extra render time, but you know, that's to be expected. Okay, I'm gonna just switch back to direct lighting for the rest of this tutorial. And actually the video you saw at the beginning was done in the GI ambient occlusion mode. It's not realistic, but I didn't mind the look it gave me. I think it was you know, good looking enough where I could use it as a render. Let me disable this buffer, and I'm gonna increase the max samples to 256 just so the noise we're looking at here clears up a bit more. And at this stage, let's go back to trying to recreate the example here. So the light turns on at the end of the animation. We want to do the same thing here. We need to put a light in the interior section. Let's go to the end first of all, when it's darker, and let's get that light. Actually, I'm going to use the area light from Octane. And it comes in over here for some reason, so I have to bring this back into the interior section, and let's rotate this to face down and push this up to the top of the ceiling here, so as high as it will go, somewhere about there. I can jump into the camera, and now we get this kind of thing. Okay, a few things here. The reflection I'm getting, I don't really like this. I want this to be a small circle, you know, maybe it's some kind of lampshade effect. So I'm gonna go into the actual light settings, and you will still have some of the regular Cinema 4D controls. So for example, I am changing the area shape to disk, and the size I'm gonna have as, let's say, 50 by 50. And now it's just a smaller circle of light on the inside there. You can see that as I changed the size down, it affected the brightness of the light as well, which is realistic. You know, the surface brightness is linked to the, or rather the brightness is linked to the surface area of the light. But you can untick this in the light settings, which means regardless of the size of the light, it's always going to have the same brightness. So that's an option that's available to you. I'm going to lower the power though to about 50 or so. And I'm also going to change the temperature to be about 2800, which is going to be a warmer type of light. You could use light color if you wanted to. So if I turn this on and go back to the light in the general settings, I can dial in my own color. And you could do this to create some interesting looking you know, lighting, and really put in any color you want. But for this, we can just stick to the color used by the temperature slider over here. And this doesn't seem to re-update by itself, so I'm gonna just turn this to white so the scene doesn't look strange in the viewport over here. Okay, this is looking quite interesting. And of course, this, you know, in the animation, we only want this light to turn on after the daylight has faded away. So I think that's going to be somewhere around 7 seconds. So if I go to about 6 seconds, I can set a keyframe for the power of this light to start at zero and then move forward 1 second and set this to, you know, say 50. Now, actually, the sun hasn't completely disappeared at this stage. So maybe the end time could be higher. So instead of ending at 8 p.m., let's go to 2100 hours. So the fade of the daylight is going to happen a bit sooner. And when that happens, my indoor lighting is going to switch on. I could even make a copy of this light. Say, move it to the right side a bit more here, just so we illuminate that inside section a bit more, and maybe actually push it further back as well. I can come in here and do this properly, move this to about there in this interior. Okay, jumping back into our camera, this is with one light. Or this is with two lights, and this is with just the one. So just, you know, an extra light there. No, not necessary, but can just make this a bit more balanced looking and more interesting. And here, again, I just want to show you what changing the GI mode is going to do. So, you know, in ambient occlusion mode, we just have this kind of frame where the illumination we're getting in the scene is only based on the original lights which are in the scene. This is like in Cinema 4D before you turn on global illumination. I'm gonna turn on another render buffer so we can do a quick comparison. Let me change this mode back to diffuse and we can see what that's going to do. And if I'm doing a still frame of this scene, I would definitely be using diffuse, and even in animation actually, if this was a real project, I would definitely be using the GI diffuse mode. I may not switch to path tracing fully just because my system is not that powerful, and it would just take too long to render. So GI diffuse would be a good compromise in between trying to still have a decent render time and also some better looking renders. So just a quick comparison here. One thing you will notice is the ambient occlusion mode does not have as much noise as when you turn turn to GI diffuse. So in GI diffuse, I would have to bump up my settings in order to clean up that noise. But you know, that's fairly straightforward. You just bump that up until your render looks acceptably clean. Okay, before I move on and look at a few of the other settings here, I'm gonna, first of all, let's remove this comparison. I'm gonna switch back to GI ambient occlusion just so it's a bit faster. And I'm gonna go back to the daytime section, and I'm going to jump maybe out of this camera into a free roam camera, and let's look at some of the textures. So the main material that's currently applied right now, if I can find it quickly, it's this concrete texture. So if I go to all, okay, here it is, just one of my presets. You know, it's all image based. So in the diffusion channel, we've got the main image, and this is an octane diffuse material because there is no reflection on this particular preset. There is some bump, of course, so turning this on and off, maybe if I get closer, you can see this a bit better. I don't know how good YouTube quality is. So that's the main concrete material, very simple and straightforward. There is a wood material on the inside a section here, we can look at that quickly as well. So let's see if I can find it quickly. My scene is not that organized. And this is a glossy material. So we've got specular, which is controlling the reflection. We can go to the index here and play around with this to increase or decrease the amount of reflection. I was actually using some custom IOR values or index values materials to get the most realism out of these presets. So perhaps what that's more obvious is if I look at the marble material that's on these this floor on the outside. So that's this material. Again, this is glossy also. So you just see some reflection, and it's, you know, this blurry reflection. And again, using a custom IOR value, we can change what this looks like. So all of these are customizable, of course, but the presets will look good anyway, just as they come. But you know, you can customize them to be exactly what you want. Okay, maybe apply a few different concrete materials in the scene. One of my favorite ones is this D Concrete 33, and any of these labeled with you know, D in the name, it means I have done something with the displacement channel. So I want to show this one to you. And I mean, this is going back to yesterday's video when I was just showcasing just that aspect of Octane and how well the displacement channel works. I want to go to this though and tile it a bit smaller, and we could come in here real close just to check out what the displacement is doing. So if I turn this off, that's without displacement, and with displacement you have the actual depth, and the light interacts with it much better. It just looks nicer and more realistic. Okay, and in this pack, you know, there are other presets, so we could maybe take a look at a few. It's not just concrete. You've also got, you know, a section with some brick shaders. So we could grab one of these white ones and just see how they will look. Let's jump back to our wider angle. And we get this kind of thing, and maybe this one would be tiled a bit smaller, so maybe, you know, 0.5 or something like that. I guess that's the wrong way. It needs to be 2. So the size of the blocks is gonna be smaller. There is another section here with this stucco presets. You could try those out too. And actually, what might be interesting here is playing with some of the wood presets to actually shade the entire building. And I've just skipped the video a bit. I'm playing with some of the wood presets, you know, actually putting them on the building instead. But this is really just for fun and experimenting. I would still likely just use regular concrete for the outside, but there's no limitation to what you can do with these. And I think in this case, GI Diffuse would look really great on this because of the way that this, the color of this wood bounces the light around the scene with just some warmer tones and you know, a different kind of shadow. I think that's gonna look really great here. So anyway, that's just a quick showcase of some of the materials. I'm gonna just go back to what we were looking at before with the concrete preset, because I wanna go over some of the settings in Octane, and also the camera imager and post settings, and so on. So anyway, back to direct lighting, and I'm using GI Diffuse. One of the settings you should watch out for if you're doing animation is this coherent ratio. For stills, it can be quite high. For example, I think you could keep it at the default 0.4, which might still be a bit too high though, so maybe bump it down to 0.3. The higher this is, the faster your render will complete. But for animation, this needs to be set to zero, because if it's not, then you will have flickering in your frames. As you know, as you render frame for frame, there will be flickering in your animation. I can't really show that to you here, but you can do your own tests and just, you know, the idea is you would find the highest possible number for this that does not introduce flickering into your scene. But I find most of the time this basically has to be zero, which will bump up your render time. But for animations, it means you will have no flickering. For stills, like I said, you could, you know, bump this up a bit more, but actually not too high, because if this is too high, the scene will look really strange and you will get some strange artifacts going on. So if you can see on the inside here, it now looks very splotchy and just really, you know, this looks like garbage. So don't do that. Either stick to somewhere in the range of the default. Unless you're doing an animation, then turn it all the way down to zero, or as low as you can without introducing flickering. Moving on with the settings, let's look at the camera imager. This is something I will always adjust. I'm going to store this render buffer, and currently I like the camera imager settings, but these are the defaults, and I always change this as well. So if I go to the settings here, first of all, the response, this is based on these presets, and if you know anything about old school film photography or 35mm photography, you will recognize that these are names of different types of films. So I guess the idea here is Octane tries to mimic the different looks that these different types of film would get you in real life. So you can see Ektachrome, for example, it's very contrasty, you know, blows out the highlights, has more saturation and so on. But it's unlikely you will be applying these to your scene. Anyway, I like to actually change this to linear, which ends up being too dark. So I have to go to the gamma and set this to 2.2. And to me, this gives me a nice neutral and predictable image. And I can compare this to the default preset, which didn't look too bad, but I just like the look that I get from the linear setting. And it just brings down the highlights some more. Nothing is getting blown out anymore. But even with this, there is a highlight compression control which you can use in your scene anyway. So currently it's set to 0.6, which means I am not losing detail in the highlights here. But if this was lower, you know, you start to lose that highlight detail. So you can use this slider just to bring back some detail in the bright spots, or, you know, by adjusting your lighting and so on. Maybe don't have them so bright that things get blown out. Also, I don't set any vignette in the render. There is no need to bake vignette into the frame. You can always do this later in After Effects if you need to. And of course, there are other controls here, but what's relevant to this scene, that's all I'm gonna change. And in post, you could turn this on just to see what that does. You know, bloom power is like diffusion and glow. The glare is similar, just a bit different in the way that it operates. In other tutorial, we'll be looking at examples where these settings will have a more pronounced effect. In this case, I don't really want to enable this any post work. I think I could do by myself later in After Effects. But that would be it for the settings. If I wanted to render this now, I would go back to my kernels and then work out how many samples I need before the noise level is acceptable. I think in the example you saw, I was using 10/24 samples, and I think that was getting me about 3 minutes per frame on a single GTX 1080. So, you know, it's not that fast. I ran the render overnight, so, you know, I just left my computer running, and in the morning, most of it had finished rendering. But again, if this were for a still, then, you know, I would be looking at possibly going to path tracing, just because I know the overall look will be better. I would still lower these settings, you know, maybe to say 2000 samples, maybe not have the diffuse and specular depth so high, and you know, continue optimizing this. But again, this is where I would refer you guys to the tutorials by InLife 3D Designs. They are truly excellent material, and even the ones which are free are very useful. I am going to be making my own Octane tutorials and posting them to the channel, you know, looking at different types of scenes and real examples. But in the meantime, this is a great place to learn Octane, especially the, you know, the technical stuff and all of the different types of settings in Octane Render. But anyway, that would be it for this video. Again, please check out the new Octane textures on the store, and like I said, I will link everything below this video to each of these pages, and hopefully some of you guys will pick these up for your own material libraries. But that's it from me. Thanks for watching, and I will see you next time.